speed cup of the Wind Mountain Fire.
Yes, okay. Praise God, amen. I'm excited to share my testimony tonight, amen. I came to Arizona in 1986. I just turned 19 years old. I was stationed out here in the Air Force. And about a year later, thank God for this church, amen. People were witnessing, revival was happening. Brother Mel witnessed to me in a place you probably should witness to people. But I left New York, and on the outside it looked like, well, he's getting a job, he's putting his life together. But I tell you, sin kind of tore me up on the inside. I didn't think that, it's like it's cringeworthy to talk about them because you're so shady today. Thank God, amen. I came here and I got involved in the same thing, because wherever you go, there you are. And a year later, there I was, just empty. You don't have to be that old to realize sin will leave you broken and empty. And thank God, at the right time, amen, I got witnessed to, and I got saved, man. I didn't get religion. I saw religion, amen. But I got converted, amen. God blessed me in this church, amen. God gave me more than I thought I could have. God blessed with a good wife in this church, kids in this church, ministry in this church, my whole life, amen. And, maybe you hear it and you're like, oh, that's kind of interesting, but I got it. No, you don't. You think I'm so odd. But 33 years later, that the grace of God, amen. I'm even more odd than I was, like I said, because I began to know me, and I'm like, oh, God. So you're here, amen. I pray God just lift the blinds from your eyes, amen. You open your eyes and see, man. Jesus is coming back. Look at what's going on in the world today. Amen. I pray you would come to this altar, even before the service is over, man, and give your life to Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah. We're going to sing a Christmas song with a little modern spin.
It's cold here.
Hallelujah.
Oh, this is waiting for you. The list. What does ring? I thought you were getting it for the fruit. Sorry.
All is on.
And another character this morning, I preached about Esther, began as an orphan and ended as a queen. Tonight is a totally different story. And sad to say, this is a picture of many in life. Tonight is the picture of a man who began in this scripture with every advantage. Totally opposite of Esther. And yet ended in a disaster. You wonder if this is where the old proverb or the axiom came, give a man enough rope and he'll hang himself. I ask you this evening, are you building your own gallows by your decisions and your attitude? Are you digging a hole that if you're not very, very careful one day, you'll fall into it? I want to minister this evening on the hanging of Haman, Esther chapter 7, verse 9. Now Harbona, one of the eunuchs, said to the king, look, the gallows 50 cubits high, which Haman constructed, are made for Mordecai, who spoke good on the king's behalf, is standing at the house of Haman. Then the king said, hang him on it. So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared for Mordecai. And the king's wrath subsided. Father, we come tonight by your blood. God, I pray, let not one here waste their lives. God, let them not be snared by just a couple of incidents or one person. God, I pray blessing them. Give them revelation, God, on how to survive life and people. In Jesus' name, save the lost. I want you to think with me first about Haman the gifted. Here's a man that has so much going for him. As I mentioned, his story begins so different than Esther's. She is first mentioned as an orphan. Mother died in birth. Most scholars believe her father soon after. But listen to Haman's introduction. Esther 3, verse 1. After these things, King Ahasuerus promoted Haman and advanced him and set his seat above all the princes who were with him. So here are three statements. He was promoted, he advanced, and he was set above all of his peers. He was elevated to such a place, all of the servants of the king were commanded, when Haman walked by, they were to bow down to him. So here's a man who has position, he has influence, he has power, he has possibilities. Here's a man that people dream about being in his circumstances. People only imagine to live like that. He's also wealthy. Esther 3:9. I will pay 10,000 talents of silver. One estimate that would be over $3 billion today. We're talking if you spent $5 every second of your life, it'd take like 200,000 years to spend 10,000 talents of silver. So here's a man who has recognition, he has wealth, he has position, He has relationships. The Bible records he has a family. He's healthy. There's no record of any sickness or illness. Esther 5:10. Haman sent and called for his friends and his wife Zeresh. Verse 11, then Haman told him of his great riches, the multitude of his children, everything in which the king had promoted him, how he had advanced him above all the officials and the servants of the king. So here's a man that outwardly, even as Ralph mentioned, seemed to have every advantage in life. He has a wife. He has, he said, a multitude of children. He has friends. He's promoted. He's advanced. He has the ear of the king. And think of that. Besides all of that, Queen Esther has invited no one but him and the king to a banquet she has prepared. How's that life sound to you? I mean, what more really in many senses in the natural could you ask for? I mean, how many here could use more money? How many here could use a promotion? How many here could use an advancement? How many would like to have some powerful person's ear? And so we have to assess, here's a man of ability. Here's a man of intelligence. Here's a man of gifting. Here's a man with so many advantages in life. Power. He has authority. And so looking at, think of all of the things and the possibilities of his future. Think of the potential in his house, even his children, grandchildren, not even born yet. All of that's waiting for him. Here is a man, when you read this chapter of his life, it's almost like a fairy tale. It's almost like some Disneyland movie. It's so advantage and everything going for him. But he has a glitch. He has a fault line, this fracture in his character. Like so many people. And he's going to waste and squander all of this because he's obsessed with one man who wouldn't bow. One person who did not respond to him in the manner that he assumed this man should respond. Said he wouldn't pay homage. He wouldn't bow down. But Mordecai, Esther 3:2, would not bow or pay homage to Haman. Now watch the fracture in this man's personality and character begin to dominate his whole existence. Esther 3, verse 5, when Haman saw that Mordecai did not pay him homage, Haman was filled with wrath. It's like all he saw, he couldn't see all of his influence, all of his wealth, his children, his family, the possibilities of you. All he saw, the fracture in his personality was like this microscope, this telescope. All he saw was this one person. How they responded toward him. Is that you? It can't be. It's too many people, actually. This word, he's filled with wrath, rage, fury, vexation. In other words, now it's beyond reason, it's beyond rationale. He's obsessed with this one person. His soul now, his mind, his emotions are flooded and consumed with this one person and how they're reacting and responding. Is that you? Is that you? One of the things about the Bible you've heard me say is try to find yourself in the Bible. I mean, it's like this one individual has blinded him to all of this great dimension of possibility in his life. He's mentally, emotionally, he's gripped with this one experience, this slight. He's willing, in verse 6, and now it moves not just from this one person, but his entire race. That's not just one guy. I'll pay 10,000 talents of silver, today $7 billion. Verse 13, to destroy, to kill, to annihilate all the Jews, both young, old, little children, women, in one day. I wonder how many people, their life goes off the rails. They forfeit an incredible future. Throw away everything because of one perceived offense, be it true or false. It's like the spiritual Achilles heel of this man. It's like this one instance, this few, this one person. It's like now this is dominating and driving his entire personality. That staggers my mind. That's why you've heard me preach for years. You've got to leave that to God. I leave people with God. The question is, how does this happen? Why would you allow this to happen? Watch this play out in Haman's life. Esther 5:9. Haman went out that day joyful. Think of this, joyful and glad of heart. In other words, he's having a fantastic day. His heart is filled with joy, with expectation, with excitement. It's a glorious day. And then watch this. But when Haman saw Mordecai, did not stand or tremble before him, he was filled with indignation against Mordecai. This is a social emotion. Indignation is a social emotion. What I mean, it has to do, it's triggered by people. It's an intense, driven frustration and hostility at someone. It's public. He goes home to his family and friends, and he tells them of his wealth. He mentions the multitude of his children, how the king has promoted him, and all of these statements, and yet none of that means anything. And he says this in the same verse, Esther 5:13, as long as I see Mordecai the Jew sitting in the king's gate. Now remember, in the spirit of the Bible, the king's gate was a place of authority. Lot sat in the gate. It means you were kind of like a politician, or you were there as a counselor. You were there in some form or position to serve the king. He said all of this, even out of his own mouth, all of this, all that I have, all that I'm experiencing, all the opportunities, all the position, the advancement, the promotion, the joy, everything, this means nothing. This one person. How many of us here, we have this fracture in our personality when someone don't respond to us? way we think they should. Because in your mind, in your eyes, one person, one experience, or a handful of experiences. Now, all the good things mean nothing. I've seen this over and over, pastoring for 40-some years. I've seen people with one hiccup in their marriage, and now all of a sudden they forget all the good things. One crisis, now they can't see any good in God. One conflict, and now all of a sudden, nobody loves me, the whole church, it's everybody. One disappointment, and they become obsessed. Listen to me, right here, beware of advice. Most of us don't need advice if you're any age at all, every day. Many times, not any major advice, even every year. But there will be a few times in your life that the advice you hear and receive is the difference between life and death. It's the difference between destiny and missing God. It's the difference between finding your purpose or wandering in the wilderness like the children of Israel. It's not every day, as I said, it's not every week, it's not even normally every year. But there are some times in life when someone's counsel, their advice, is the difference. And it's true in this case. You've heard me tell the story. When Gail died, I went to Pastor Mitchell. We're pastoring Mary, good church, great time. I mean, we love the Midwest, raised in the Midwest. And he said, just a moment, let me get right back to you. And he came back and he said, what about Chad? And we had a conversation. I said, what do you think? He says, I think you'd do fantastic. I think it'd be a great opportunity. I think I need you there. Think of that one decision. Think of the advice. Those closest to you become extremely important at this time. Your spouse and your friends, and if you're wise, it should include your pastor. Esther 5:14, then his wife, Zeresh, and all of his friends said to him, let a gallows be made 50 cubits high, three times at least as tall as this building. Suggest to the king Mordecai be hanged on him. How many times have those closest to you given you advice that's going to destroy you? I've heard me say for years, want to know your future? Take a photograph of your friends because they have influence on your decisions. Hear this wife and friends, their advice, listen. A gallows, 50 cubits, some 75 feet high. You need to build that to hang a Mordecai. How different than the virtuous woman or wife in Proverbs 31:26. She opens her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the law of kindness. Wives, what kind of advice do you give your husband? Or husbands, your wives. What kind of counsel? She said her words were filled with wisdom. kindness. What kind of advice do you know? You can inflame your husband. You can throw fuel on the fire. Or you can put it out and say with your wife. You can ignite her or him. And you can join in. But if you're not careful, you're going to give advice that one day is going to end horribly. How different from Abigail. Remember Nabal's wife, Abigail? Great story in David's life, and I won't replay the whole thing, but David's upset that Nabal was going to kill him and everyone in the house. Got blood in his eye. And he's on the way to do this, and Abigail meets David. 1 Samuel 25:20. Please listen to me, David. Let your maidservant speak in your ears. And basically, she said, David, don't do this. Hasn't God always taken, she talks about the rock and the sling killing Goliath. Talks about, listen, David, don't do something. We know you're going to be king one day. Don't do something today that's going to damage your influence tomorrow. Don't do something today that people will use against you tomorrow. Don't do this today that later down the road it's going to be a shame and embarrassment to you. What incredible advice. Don't do something today that's going to cause great grief tomorrow. And listen to David. 1 Samuel 25:30. And David said to Abigail, blessed is your advice. Do people say that about you? Do people say, oh, blessed. Oh, honey, thank you. Thank you, baby. Thank you. Say it. Thank you for your time. People come to you and say, oh, that counsel you gave me. Shh. Everyone wants the pastor. You'll live with the counsel you give people. They don't just live with it. You live with it. So, thank you. The problem so many times with advice, in other words, with Haman, there's no mystery here what he wants to hear. In other words, his wife would know if anyone knew. His friends would know. He is upset with Mordecai. I mean, it doesn't take rocket science to understand many times when people come to you what they're wanting to hear from you. But what they're wanting to hear is so many times not what they need to hear. She says, build a gallows. So the whole world can see it. All the neighbors. I mean, later it talks about the eunuch. He said, there's the gallows. It's in Haman. Build it in your backyard. Think of this. I mean, this is your children are going to see this. It said he had children. What kind of counsel, what kind of advice do you give? Why the Bible talks about those who sow strife and discord, jealousy and envy. God says, I hate those people. Because that's the advice many times. That's how they sow it. They sow it. Strike. They love their tail bearers. They love to bring stuff that's going to cause agony and conflict and division. God says, I hate those people. Here's a man, again, that has, so to speak, the world at his fingertips in the natural. And yet this fracture in his character and the advice he's given. What if his wife said, listen, honey, listen. No, bad idea. Don't go there. Don't do that. Don't do that. You want to quit church? No. because you're upset. So don't do that. Don't go there. Or your wife. World's filled with advice, especially today with the social media. Like everybody on planet Earth has an opinion. They want to put in their 2 cents, and that's about what it's worth, 2 cents. People who never built anything or done anything always have the answers and the advice on how you need to do things. I had a pastor one time a number of years ago tell me how to disciple men. And I'm listening to it, you know. And I said, so where's your disciples? Who are you launching? And I was gracious, but I'm thinking to myself, I don't want your advice. I mean, theology long as my leg on discipleship. Tell him about all these sermons he was preaching on discipleship. And glory to God. I understand he's a pioneer, but this guy wasn't a pioneer. The difficulty, as I said many times, good advice is not accepted well. Hey, listen. Don't waste your life, your wife, your children, your future, in this arena. Ever have someone just say, you need to be in prayer? Can I say, you need to be in prayer? If you're going to be in ministry, be in prayer. Be in prayer. Is that too hard to understand? You're going to be in ministry because you minister who and what you are. Be in prayer. Be in church. Be in the book, the Bible. Don't go there. That's good advice. Don't go there. No, that's a no-no. Remember your children? Teach your children that when they're small. Don't take every valuable you got and put it up high. But teach them, don't touch. Don't touch. I know that's old school, but listen, it works. Pain is an excellent instructor. Don't go there. That'll hurt you. Let me close. The hanging of Haman. This man has a pride problem. Bible said God resists the proud and gives more grace to the humble. The Bible said pride goeth before destruction. Pride always sees a different picture. The problem with pride, it colors and alters every experience in life. It's like it changes the lens of how you're going to interpret this experience. Pride always has to be the most popular player, the center of the stage, always has to have an audience, because pride is always about you. Watch pride. It never sees God. No record that Haman ever prayed. In other words, watch when the hand of God is at work. I talked about that this morning. And I'll mention this more with Mordecai. The king has a dream one night, and he wakes up, and I've had a dream. Bring me, I can't sleep. Bring me the books. Bring me the records. It's kind of like some of you. You want to sleep, you read your Bible. He's reading, and he reads about this account of Mordecai when two of his people on staff were plotting an assassination, And Mordecai, I heard about it. And he sent word to the king. He said, listen, these guys are going to kill you. And so the king had him arrested and put to death, etc. He's reading, he says, what's been done for Mordecai? To the scribe, he says, what have we ever done for Mordecai? He says, we haven't done anything. So he said, who's in the court? He said, oh, Haman. He just happened to walk by. Watch Esther 6:6. So Haman came in, and the king asked him, what shall be done for the man whom the king delights to honor? Now Haman thought in his heart, who would the king delight to honor more than me? He must be talking about me. And that's so much pride. It has to be me. Who else on planet Earth? Never enters mind that there's other people that need to be heard, other people that need to be recognized, other people that need to be promoted. Haman answered, let the royal robe that the king has worn be put upon him. Let the horse, the stallion, the steed that the king has worn on, bring it out. The crest, the royal crest, put it on the horse, son. And then let one of the kings, let one of his noblemen lead the horse through the city of Chandler, down Main Street, Arizona Avenue, right downtown, and declare, this is the one who the king will honor. This is the one who the king will honor. I mean, in his mind, that's going to be him sitting on the horse. And the king said, that's a fantastic idea, Haman. All that you've said to me, I want you to do that to Mordecai. Can you imagine? Can you imagine his mind? Here's the guy. He's building a gallows to Haman. Listen, there's always the God. Don't you love the God factor? Don't you love the God factor in life? If God be for me, who in the world can be against me? If God wants to bless me, the whole world can't stop. You think at this point he would have stopped and said, you know what? Maybe I need to tear down that gallows. Maybe this is not a good idea. But you know what the Bible says he did? Once he paraded Mordecai, I wonder what Mordecai is thinking, sitting up there on the steed. You know, Jews are always short. He's on the 16 hands highest, stunning, majestic kings. I wonder what's going through his mind. And it's all public, see? It's all public. All of these other servants and princes and all of these other staff and counselors, they would have all watched this. Wonder how. Bible says Haman covered his head. Hurried home. He ran home. Mourning with his head covered. It's interesting now, all those people who gave advice changed their advice. But it's too late. You ever have people give you advice, your life is falling apart. Now they have come along and say, well, maybe that wasn't such a good idea. Too late. Too late. Godly advice and good advice is presented before it's too late, not after the fact. I've had people over the years, I'm Mormon, but listen, dear, let him live for God. Let him live for God before you give him your heart. Don't do this. And just talk to him Friday. is asking you. Not just honestly. Not just honestly. So, my daughter, I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't do it. And a number of years ago in my office, this guy came, and he's going to marry a girl from here. I had her parents in the office with me. And he's telling me, I said, you're telling me you want to preach? You want to pastor this young man standing there with the fiance? Well, she's not yet. They're ready to be engaged. Her parents are. You're telling me you want to go in the ministry? I've never seen her worship God. I've never seen her in the prayer group. I've never seen her in the outreach. Why would you want to marry her? And her parents are sitting there. Thank God they agree with it. Now down the road, a few years, he didn't listen. It's a disaster today. We're not even together. But he can't say, I didn't warn him. Watch it now. When Haman told his wife and all of his friends and his wise men, his wife Zeresh said to him, Mordecai, before whom you have begun to fall, is of Jewish descent, you will not prevail against him, but will surely fall before him. And as they're speaking, when the king's servants knocks at the door and says, quick, Haman, come. Remember, the queen has a banquet. And in this banquet, the plot of Haman is revealed. Listen, our God is all about justice. God of faithfulness. Help me. Old song. I asked Jason about his pastor. I don't know that song. God of faithfulness without injustice. Upright is he. Esther 7:9. Now Harbona, one of the king's eunuchs, said to the king, look, the gallows 50 cubits high, Haman made for Mordecai. Then the king said, hang him on it. So they hanged Haman on the gallows that he had prepared. For Mordecai. Be careful what you're building. Be careful you're not building your own gallows. By your decision, I wonder what he's thinking when he's going up the steps. I wonder what he's thinking. They're going to hang him. Be careful you don't hang yourself with your own decision. Be careful by how you treat people and view people. You don't create a gallows for yourself. I wonder if he's still blaming Mordecai. Because that's what people do many times. You create your own disaster. And when you're caving into it, the tendency is to blame people. Wonder what he's thinking. His last few minutes of life. Be careful what you plan for other people. What you wish on other people. What you devise for other people. What you say and speak about other people. Because it has the incredible ability to come back and bite you. He was hung, so to speak, by his own rope. We need to be very, very careful in life who you put your hand to. Who you lay your hand on, your mouth on. Because there is a God in heaven. He is a moral God. And that's been my confidence. You've heard me say for years, right will come out right if you get right. Don't build something that later can really do you damage. He really hung himself. And no record that he ever had a conversation of any kind with Mordecai. All of this transpired over an office. Jesus said, offenses will come. You can't live life without somebody upsetting you. So how many have ever been upset by somebody? They're here tonight, not always. They're sitting as dog. But listen. How different. Think of this. They're born possibly around the same time. They're living in the same era. They're both in the king's palace. One began an orphan, disadvantaged, outministered this morning. The other born with so many pluses, and yet look at the end. What was the difference? The difference was how they perceived it. I mean, you don't ever hear of Esther. You don't hear of her speaking about wanting to destroy someone. You don't hear of any bitterness. I mean, even if you read the whole story, Haman throws himself on her in the king's palace when it's all revealed, when she's having the banquet, and you don't hear one word out of her. The king comes in and has him drug out. How different. And yet, Haman, it's like his whole story is being obsessed with the destruction and the demise. All of life follows after two. Remember this one I said seven times, it's recorded. She had favor. Do you have favor? Favor. Favor is a social term. It's an open door. It's an acceptance. It's how people perceive you. They want to be with you and around you. They want what you have. You're pleasant. You're a joy. I encourage you, choose her spirit. Choose Joseph's spirit. I encourage you. Listen, life, all life. Probably hates my people if I'm still here. No. but life, so many different chapters. But listen, it's how you process those chapters. It's your attitude, it's your spirit, it's your relationship with God. Oh, you take some hits in time. It's inescapable. But that's not the end. That's not the end. Just the word of advice. Don't create something that has the ability to hang you. Would you bow your head with me this evening? Thank you. Oh, Ramashanda, God, we love you in this place. And you know the wonderful thing in the New Testament? Is Haman could have cried out to God. I mean, Peter threw some trash out there. Cursed and not even knew the Lord. I mean, he threw some junk in the street. And yet, Jesus said, go tell my disciples and Peter, I want to speak with him. And Peter made a reversal. Peter repented. Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Lord, you don't know. Lord, you know. No, I love you. Goes to Pentecost. Comes out of Pentecost with the word of fire. Thousands saved. You're here tonight before we do anything else. You're not saved. You're not right with God. You know that. You're living in sin. Listen, sin will always hang you somewhere down the road. It's inescapable. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. You can't sin without compounding the pain. But listen, there's a Savior. There's the love of God. There's Jesus Christ who came. I can set you free. I can forgive you. I can make you whole again. I can give you a new heart. I can give you a new life. You're here tonight. You say, Pastor, I'm not saved. I'm not born again. I'm not living for God. I know some people that I believe are Christians. But that's not been my experience. But I long for it. I long to just be forgiven. To be free. To be saved. You're here tonight. You say, Pastor Campbell, that's me. That's me you're talking to. That's me you're talking to. I need to pray. Would you lift your hand? Just lift your hand that I can see. That's me, Pastor. I'm not right with God. I'm not living for God. I need to be born again. I need to be saved. Backslider. Anyone here? Anyone here? Anyone here? I want to change the order of the service. I'm going to ask you to stand your feet. All of this building, you stand your feet. God is dealing with you. I encourage you to come. Find a place to pray. Go and talk to God. Maybe you've made some bad decisions. Maybe you're one of those people that you just say things you shouldn't say. Maybe you're caught in an instant of life. You're caught in an experience, an offense. Didn't go. They didn't do. It didn't. It just left this gall in your mouth. You need to talk to God. If you're at your seat, you may be seated. Let's pray, church. Let's pray. 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 Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
build gallows with our language. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't give people advice to do it. Don't fuel it. Don't encourage it. You know what? I've had people come to me and say, you. I mean, I'm serious. You know, that's part of the passion. I remember the time I said, hey, stop. Did you used to live with them 5 or 6 years ago? I seem like I remember you lived in their house. They fed you, didn't they? Did they charge you anything? Why do you, I mean,